Good morning, Grace Point, and welcome to our service this morning. Anybody excited to be in the house of the Lord one more time? Amen. Amen. Is anyone excited to be in the house of the Lord one more time? Amen.
Amen.
Come
amen.
On and stand to your feet as we open our worship service this morning. Amen. We want to lift up the holy name of Jesus Christ and give God all the praise. Amen. Amen. Anybody grateful this morning? I said, is anybody grateful this morning inside Grace Point? Come on, make some noise for Jesus this morning. Amen.
Grace. This is a family love.
Amen, amen. God bless you, and you may be seated. You know, the book of 1 Peter talks a lot about suffering and how to deal with difficulty and trials that we face in life, and how, you know, oftentimes God uses tough times to build us and strengthen us. And he was writing to a church that was scattered and persecuted. And listen to this couple verses. He says, "Those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good." God says it's not a question of if you're going to suffer. It's not if you're going to have hard times. It's just a question of when. And he says, when you do, remember God is faithful. Remember to trust him and to continue to do good. And then he says this, "And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ," he says, "after you've suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever." He says, "I'm writing this to you with the help of Silas, the faithful brother." He says, "I'm encouraging you and testifying, this is the true grace of God. Stand fast in it." And then a verse that took on new meaning for me this week. The next verse, it almost seems like one of those throwaway verses, like it may be not that important. Listen to what it says in the light of this week's news and current events around the world, particularly in the Middle East. Paul's writing to people that are suffering and hurting. Listen to what he says. "She who is in Babylon, chosen together with you, sends her greetings. And so does my son Mark. Greet one another with a kiss of love. Peace to all of you who are in Christ." Peter wanted to remind those suffering, persecuted believers all over the world. He wanted to remind them they had brothers and sisters in Christ in Babylon. You know where Babylon is today? It's modern day Iraq. And the Bible says that your brothers and sisters in Babylon, in the Middle East, in the midst of all this turmoil, hey, you know, you're suffering. Guess what? They're suffering too. And we need to pray. Franklin Graham, the son of Billy Graham, is an evangelist and has a ministry called Samaritan's Purse today that works all over the world. And this week, Franklin Graham encouraged churches all across America and around the world to just set aside a few moments this morning to pray for the persecuted church, especially in Afghanistan. Can you imagine what it would mean to an Afghan believer in Jesus Christ, everything that's happened in the last few weeks, and what it means for women in that part of the world, what it's going to mean for these people, and of course so many Americans and so many people that have helped the government that are now literally in harm's way. And so we want to pray today. This is not a political moment. This is a spiritual moment where people are in danger. And some of these people are believers. Now, we care about everybody, whether they're Christian or Muslim or whatever their religion. We don't want anybody to suffer. But Peter said, hey, remember those folks in Babylon. Remember the church. Pray for the persecuted church. So let's just bow our hearts this morning all over this room if you're joining us online. And let's pray for the safety. We pray for the protection of God, the faithfulness of God. And let's pray for mercy for this war-torn land. Father, we do lift up folks in Afghanistan this morning that are hurting, that are afraid. And Lord, they've got every reason to be afraid. But Lord, we thank you that you are our faithful Creator. And that, Lord, you have called us. Even sometimes when we suffer, even sometimes when we face adversity and maybe persecution, that, Lord, you give us the grace and the courage to stand fast. And Father, we thank you that that there are men and women and young people, boys and girls that love you and know you. And Father, we just pray that you would post angels around them and protect them somehow, some way. And Father, we just ask that you would allow people to be rescued. We pray that they would find refuge. Lord, we just pray for the safety and security of all these brothers and sisters and all these folks. And Lord, sometimes when we live in a world that doesn't make sense, we just thank you that you ultimately are in control. And that, Lord, we can lash our lives to you. And that, Lord, you can help us to be steadfast, immovable, unshakable, always abounding in your grace and in the work of God. So, Father, be with folks today all around the world. And, Father, I pray this morning you would be with folks that are right here in this room and people that are listening online, and maybe they're going through suffering or maybe they're just hurting today. And that, God, today you would bind up the brokenhearted. You would save those who are crushed in spirit. And you would give us strength and give us hope and give us peace today. In Jesus' name and for Christ's sake, we pray. Everybody said, amen. Let's continue to worship.
Forget how I feel right now on the mountain. chosen. I know who I am. I know what you've spoken. I'm already loved more than I could imagine. And that is enough.
You guys want to keep singing?
Yeah.
You got anything else, or you want me to take over? What's the busiest day of the week? Someone has said, mañana is always the busiest day of the week. And I believe that the greatest threat to a healthy life and a healthy faith, the greatest threat to a healthy faith is the disease of spiritual procrastination. I want you to take your Bible, if you would, and turn to the book of Haggai or Haggai in the Old Testament. We're in a series this summer called Postcards from the Edge. And each week we've taken a different one of these minor prophets. And remember, there's nothing minor about the message of the minor prophets. They're only called minor prophets because their books are shorter than books like Isaiah and Jeremiah. But Haggai, I would say, is a motivational prophet. He's like an Old Testament motivational speaker. You might say that Haggai is like the Tony Robbins of the minor prophets. And he's going to call God's people to get started and to get busy doing God's work. And specifically in this book, this is after the exile, when God's people have come back from Babylon and they're back in Jerusalem, but the temple's in ruins, the wall's in ruins, their faith is in ruins, and it's time to rebuild. And the same principles that Haggai is going to use to motivate and to call God's people to get started and get busy rebuilding God's house, they're the same principles that will help us to build our lives on the foundation, that firm foundation, the solid rock of God's word, the living word, Jesus Christ, the written word, the Bible, the saving word, the gospel. You can build your life. And you know, the great theologian Mary Poppins once said, well begun is what? Did you guys watch Mary Poppins? Well begun is half done. You'll never finish what you don't start. And so Haggai is going to call us to get started and get moving. And really, he's going to help us, if we'll remember a few things, he's going to help us recover from the sickness of spiritual procrastination. Now, real quick, before we really dive into the text, I just want to read a couple verses as a way of introducing this theme. Listen to what he says in verse 5. Haggai chapter 1. Listen, if you had trouble finding Haggai, don't feel bad. It's the second shortest Bible, the second shortest book in the Old Testament. It's only two chapters. And in chapter 1, verse 5, listen to what he says. Now, this is what the Lord says. Give careful thought to your ways. Give careful thought to your ways. Go over to verse 7, chapter 1, verse 7. This is what the Lord says. Give careful thought to your ways. Look over at chapter 2, verse 15. Chapter 2, verse 15. Anybody want to just take a wild guess at what this one says? Verse 15, now give careful thought from this day on. Consider how things were before. And then go down to verse 18. From this day on, from this 24th day of the ninth month, give careful thought to the day when the foundation of the Lord's temple was laid. And in case you haven't messed it up until now, he ends that sentence, that verse saying, give careful thought to this. You think maybe there's a message here that Haggai is saying? That phrase, give careful thought or consider, is repeated five times in these two short chapters. It's a compound Hebrew word that means to put or place in your heart. To put in heart. It's the concept of to put in mind. To put it in your heart. He's saying, I want you to remember this. Now, there was a man in 1968. He was a scientist at the 3M Corporation. And he was in research and development. His name is Spencer Silver. In 1968, Spencer Silver, this PhD scientist who's working on all these different products, he was trying to find a super strong adhesive. Do you ever watch those infomercials about the boat where they just spray paint chicken wire and you can go across the lake and that kind of thing? Spencer Silver, Dr. Silver, was trying to invent the strongest adhesive that could be used for business and military and all kinds of purposes. And by accident, he invented this low-tack, pressure-sensitive, reusable adhesive. He was trying to create a super strong adhesive. What he ended up doing was, by accident, he stumbled on a very light adhesive. And he had a guy that was working in the lab next door to him, and the guy had a bunch of yellow paper laying around. And so Dr. Silver took that yellow paper, and he created what you and I know of today as Post-it notes. Isn't that odd? And what Haggai is really doing here in his prophecy, in his message, is he's going to give us three Post-it notes to help us remember how to recover from the disease of spiritual procrastination. Now, how many of you aren't really sure if you need to hear this sermon? Do any of you think, maybe I should hear this sermon tomorrow? but maybe not right now. Haggai says, hey, listen, wake up. Pay careful attention to what God is saying. What are the three post-it notes that we're going to find? If you have something to write with, you might want to just jot these down. Number one is this. Remember, first of all, if you're going to get motivated and stay motivated, he says you've got to remember, number one, God is in you. Remember that God is in you. How do you see that? Look at verse 2. Chapter 1, verse 2, Haggai. The Lord, the Bible says, this is what the Lord Almighty says. These people say, these are the people of Judah in Jerusalem, after coming back from the Babylonian captivity, the temple's in ruins. God says, these people, my people say, the time has not yet come to rebuild the Lord's house. Did God's people know that the house was in ruins? Did they know that they needed to rebuild that temple? Did they know how significant that was? Because that's where the presence of God dwelled. That's where the sacrifices, the high priest. In other words, until that temple was rebuilt, they couldn't encounter God in the same way. They couldn't experience God's grace. They wouldn't taste God's forgiveness in that way on the Day of Atonement. In other words, they knew they needed to do it. They just didn't need to do it today. It was something for later. Some of you are young people or young adults here this morning. And you know what I think a lot of young people think? They think, you know, God is really important and the Bible is true and Jesus is a real source of life and hope and he's the way, the truth, and life. And you know, when I grow up, I'm going to get interested and I'm going to get real involved in that. And some people say, well, you know, I'm single right now and I'm just having fun. I'm doing my thing. And, you know, when I get married, that's when I'm really going to settle down and I'm going to get serious about faith. And then people get married and they say, you know, once we have kids, you know, kids really need to be in church. Isn't that kind of the way people think? And how many of us that are parents know that once you have kids, you really don't have time to think about anything else? So if you wait and wait and wait, the problem with tomorrow is it's always a day away. And he says, they say it's not time. Look at verse 3. Then the word of the Lord came through the prophet Haggai. Is it a time for you yourselves to be living in your paneled houses while this house remains a ruin? Now, this is what the Lord Almighty says, verse 5. Give careful thought. You've planted much, but you've harvested little. He says, you eat, but you never have enough. You drink, but you never have your fill. You put on clothes, but you're not warm. You earn wages only to put them in a purse with holes in it. In a sense, Gerald, Haggai is singing a song saying, God is the only thing. God is the only one that is really enough to meet the needs of our heart. He's saying Jireh, Jehovah Jireh, the God who provides, that he is enough. But a life without him is never enough. And he says, I want you to give careful thought to your ways. Look at verse 8. Go up into the mountains and bring down timber and build my house so that I may take pleasure. Notice this phrase, that I may take pleasure in it and be honored, says the Lord. Verse 12 says, they went ahead and they obeyed the voice of the Lord, and the people, feared the Lord. What is the significance of the temple? Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 3. We're going to look at a few verses up here. David, do we have that? 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 10 and 11, and then 16 and 17. Paul says to the church at Corinth, now by the grace God has given me, I laid a foundation as a wise builder, and someone else is building on it. But each one should build with care. Paul is trying to build the church in the New Testament, same way Haggai was trying to build the temple, literally, in the Old Testament. They're both doing God's work with God's people. Look at what he says next. You can't lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ. Look at verse 16 and 17. He says, don't you know that you yourselves are what? You are God's temple, and that God's Spirit dwells where? In you, in your midst, right? Look at verse 17. Anyone who destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person, for God's temple is what? Sacred, and say it with me. You together are that temple. Haggai is trying to rebuild this temple. Why? Because God was in it. Because that's where you could meet God. That's where you could hear from God. That's where you could experience the grace of God. And Paul says, we're trying to build God's church the same way that God had a temple. Someone has said, in the Old Testament, God had a temple for his people. But in the New Testament, God has a people for his temple. What's the point? The point is, the whole point of the Christian life is that Jesus Christ, this is the mystery, that Christ is in you. And that is the hope of glory. You don't have to come to this church and walk through those doors to experience the presence of God. You don't have to come to church and be in a building with a priest to get your prayers heard and answered. You don't have to confess in some booth, in some building, in order to get your sins forgiven. That faith is all about what God is doing in your heart. Do you need a priest? Yeah, you do. And guess what? His name is Jesus Christ. Do you need a king? Do you need somebody to be the Lord of your life? You need to know that somebody's in control? Yes, you do. And his name is Jesus Christ. Do you need to hear from God? Do you need a prophet? Yeah, you do. And guess what? It's not Stephen. It's Jesus Christ. He is the prophet, priest, and king of the Old Testament. And in the New Testament, God has spoken to us in these last days by his Son. And your relationship with Jesus Christ has to be the center point of your life. It has to be the driving force of your life. When Haggai said, God told me we need to get busy building this house, why was that so important? Because that's how they could know God and serve God. And what he's saying to us today is, you need to get busy on all the ways that you can grow in your relationship with God, and how Jesus Christ can be at the center of your life, and how he can give power and life and meaning to every part of you. Look at what it says in Colossians 3, verses 1 through 4. Paul said to the church at Colossae, since then you've been raised with Christ. Notice the themes here. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Verse 2. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. Does that sound kind of like you ought to think about building God's house instead of just building your paneled houses? Set your heart, set your mind. Kind of sounds like give careful thought to your ways. Look at verse 3. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. You died. What he's talking about here is a person who has accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior. And he's saying, David, do you know Jesus Christ as your Savior? Have you placed your faith and trust and hope in Jesus Christ for eternal life? That Jesus died on the cross to take away your sin? He rose from the dead. He has the power to make you a brand new person. What that verse says is, David, see, there's the old you before you came to Christ. And he says, guess what? That guy, we need to have a memorial service for that guy. He's not alive anymore. If anyone's in Christ, he's a new creation. The old Stephen is gone. The old David is gone. The old Gary is gone. And new life has come. Old things pass away. All things become new. Where is your old life? Your old life is dead and buried and hidden with Christ and God. It's hidden by the blood of Jesus Christ. So does God see all the rotten, nasty things that you and I thought and did and would have done if we'd have had the opportunity? Can he see them? It's a trick question. I mean, obviously he's God, he can do whatever he wants, right? But ultimately, no, he's chosen not to look at them. He has covered them with the blood of Jesus, and they are, it is that life is hidden with Christ and God. Your sin was nailed to the cross, and you bear it no more. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. I think there's a song about that. And then look at this. What's the last verse say? When Christ, David, remember where we were just a minute ago? You might have felt a little lost. Well, if I'm gone and dead and buried, well, who is this guy in the purple shirt? What am I doing here today? When Christ, who is your what? Life. When he appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. You see, the old me is gone, but the new me, Jesus Christ, is my life. It's not that the Christian life is you and I trying to live a good life for God. The Christian life is that he lived the perfect life for you. And now he wants to give you that life. Isn't that beautiful? God is in me. That's what Haggai is saying. Haggai is saying, wake up, get up, look up, stand up, speak up. He says, let's get started building a life of faith. And he says, remember that God is in you. Now, there's a second thing I want you to see. In chapter 1, verse 13, down through chapter 2, verse 9, I'm going to skip through some of these verses. I'm not going to read them all. I want you to see that not only can we be encouraged and we can recover from this sickness of spiritual procrastination, but he says, listen, you got to remember that God is in you. And secondly, write this down. Remember, God is with you. He's with you. And what does he mean by that? How does that add value and add meaning to the fact that Christ lives in you? I want to show it to you. He says in chapter 1, verse 13, then Haggai, the Lord's messenger, gave this message of the Lord to the people. I am what? I'm with you, declares the Lord. And look at verse 14. This is interesting. So the Lord stirred up. You see that? He stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel, the governor, and the spirit of Joshua the priest, and the spirit of the whole remnant of the people. That God stirred the government, and God stirred the churches, and God stirred up the whole nation. Isn't that amazing? And what was the power? What did it? It was that God is with us. Isn't that what Emmanuel means? Jesus, they'll call his name Emmanuel. Emmanuel, Hebrew, means God with us. And listen to what he says. Go down to verse 3. He says, you know, you're looking at this temple that's lying in ruins, and now you're trying to build this new temple, and you're repairing, but it's not as fancy and ornate and expensive and glamorous. The second temple just didn't hold a candle to the first temple. So they were tempted to be a little discouraged. You ever feel that way? You go through some pain, you go through some problems, you suffer something in your life. And you know what? This new car isn't as nice as that old car I used to have. I don't make as much money on my job now as I did back then, so I couldn't afford to lease that car. So now I've got this kind of car. And he's saying that's how they were looking at the temple. And it says he stirred up the people. He stirred them up. Look at chapter 2, verse 3. And he said, ask, who of you is left who saw this house in its former glory? How does it look to you now? Does it not seem to you like nothing? Verse 4. But now be strong, Zerubbabel, declares the Lord. Be strong, Joshua. Be strong, all you people of the land, and work. How? Why? Look at the end of verse 4. For I am with you. He says, I'll be with you. Look at verse 7. He says, I'm going to shake things up. I'm going to shake the nations, and I will fill this house with glory. The silver is mine. The gold is mine. The glory of this present house will be greater than the glory of the former house, says the Lord. And in this place, I will grant peace. Did you notice a lot of shaking and stirring going on? God's going to shake the nations. He's going to stir the hearts of the people. You know what I fear? I fear for many people when they come to church or they listen to a sermon or, you know, somehow they sense God's presence, they hear God's voice, to become aware of God's purpose. I think for a lot of us, we approach God the way James Bond orders his classic cocktail. We like to be shaken, but not stirred. We like to hear a word from God and sense God's power and presence. And by the time we get to the parking lot, it's about 50%. The energy level of remembering it and applying it is about 50%. And by Monday morning, when we hear God's voice, we just hit the spiritual snooze button and turn it off until next Sunday, when we really would like to be shaken once again. But God's call, the call of God, it doesn't come with a snooze button. You got to come to God on His terms, or you're not going to come to Him at all. When God calls you, you have to respond. The psalmist said, today, if you hear His voice, harden not your heart. Why is it so important that God is with us? Did you notice how many times in those verses He said, be strong? Be strong, Zerubbabel. Be strong, Joshua. Be strong to the people and get to work. And the reality is, the work God has called you to do is too big for you. What God wants to do in my life, in your life, in the life of this church, trust me, it's beyond our resources. It's beyond our intelligence. It's beyond our talent. The question is not what you can do for God. That's very limited. The question is what God can do through you. He is with us. God is in us. God is with us. Did anybody take note when we read a moment ago in chapter 1, verse 8, God told Haggai, hey, listen, I want you to go up in the mountains and get good timber. That's where the best wood was. We're going to build this house. We got to have supplies, right? Did anybody notice you didn't go downhill to get the timber? You had to go uphill to get the timber. My dad is here this morning, and I don't know how many of you were raised in a home like me, but were any of you raised in a home where your parents went to school in the snow, chased by a pack of ravenous wolves? And everybody say it with me. Uphill both ways. Can I tell you that it's kind of a counterintuitive, it's kind of a paradoxical reality here. Jesus said, come unto me, all ye that are weary and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. My yoke is easy, my burden is light. Is that the truth of God's word? But did he also tell Haggai, son, if you'll trust me, life's going to be a lot easier than trying to do it on your own. But I hate to break this to you, but you need to get up that hill. Some things in life, you got to pump water uphill. You know? It's the Spirit of God that's at work in us, but you got to get out of bed. You got to brush your teeth. You know? God wants you to do well in school, and He'll give you power and grace and wisdom, but He would like you to also do your homework. And He would like you to learn your multiplication tables. And ultimately, He's the one giving you the strength to learn. He gave you that brain for a reason. He wants you to use it. And so there's this connection. Andre and I were talking the other day about the the fact that, that sailors, people who sail, they rely on the weather, they rely on the wind. The people who sail tend to be, by nature, a fairly spiritual group of people. Sailors tend to be pretty spiritual. Why? Because they know that ocean is way too big for them. Can a farmer make a seed reproduce after its kind? No. They have to depend on God. But can I tell you a little something about sailors and farmers? They're the hardest working people in the world. They know that it's all up to God, but they also know they better be prepared for when that harvest comes. And they better have their sails trimmed for when the wind hits just right. It's not like trusting God means you don't need to take action and put into practice and apply what you're learning. It just means that you recognize the issue of good works is that they don't buy you God's love. It doesn't mean they're not important. Good works have a place in your life. But they are the caboose of your relationship with God. They're not the locomotive that's driving the engine. It's God's power that motivates us and calls us and energizes us. But then we've got to be obedient. We've got to be faithful. We've got to put into practice what God is calling us to do. Remember, first of all, God is in you. Remember, God is with you. Look at Psalm 121, verses 1 and 2. Psalm 121, it's a song of ascent. Isn't that interesting? This is what the children of Israel would sing and pray as they were going up the hill to the temple to worship. It's almost like a call to worship. This is like the prelude music before the service begins. And so the song of ascents is what they would do on their pilgrimage, and they would be going up the hill into the mountains. And what did that teach them? What did that remind them? I lift up mine eyes to the mountains. The King James famously says, I look unto the hills. From whence cometh my help? Where does my help come from? Verse 2. My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Friends, God will help you. God will empower you. But you better get on up that hill sometimes. You better get out of bed and open that Bible on your dining room table and start looking at the words on the page. Because God is there ready to help you and inspire you and strengthen you and speak to you. But you do have to open the book and read it. God will hear your prayer, and He loves you, and He's with you, but you do got to call on Him. You have to reach out. You know, there's an author named W.H. Locke, who's a fiction writer, and he tells a funny story that he was in college at Texas State University in San Marcos, Texas. And let me just tell you, I've lived in Texas. And the idea that a fiction writer came out of Texas State University is a miracle in itself. It's not Harvard, you know what I mean? He's out there in the middle of the Texas desert, and he's in this small town, and he's at this college. And what's funny about Texas State University, it was built on or on the crest or in between two hills. And literally, when he was in college, W.H. Locke had to walk uphill both ways. Wherever he was going on campus, it was uphill. And he was kind of an average student and kind of an underachiever. And one day he was in an accounting class, and he had a dynamic professor. And he was sitting there, and his eyes were glazed over. He had missed a few classes, but he was doing okay. And the class ended, and the professor said, Mr. Locke, come on up here for a minute. Now, when the teacher calls you to the front, it's usually not good news, right? He walked up to the front, and his professor said this to him. He said, son, I've been teaching for 11 years. And he said, I've had just about every kind of student that there is. And he said, I have figured you out. The young man said, well, what do you mean by that? And he said, you don't really want to be here in this class. You don't really care that much about it. And he said, you're smart enough that you're going to get a C. He said, I've done this for 11 years. You're going to get a C in this class at the rate you're going. And he says, that shouldn't satisfy you. You ought to be, you're paying a lot of money for this education. And you need something that'll get you out of bed in the morning and keep you up late at night, and something that you're learning and growing and passionate about. And he said, there's a project due on Monday. He looked at W.H. Locke and he said, I just want to tell you, don't even bother doing it. I have already given you an A. Don't do that project. I'm going to give you an A. He said, here's your assignment. Find something you really care about and give yourself to it. He walked out of that classroom. He knew exactly where to go. He knew exactly what he wanted to do. He walked to Flowers Hall. He transferred his major to English literature with a focus on fiction writing. And he said that professor was the best teacher he ever had. Donald Miller is one of my favorite authors. He wrote Blue Light Jazz. He's written a bunch of different books. He's now a business consultant. And one of the things he says is this. You know, he's talking about this for people in business and strategy for success, but the same principle applies in our personal lives. He says, this is a great principle to remember. Don't choose to be confused. What keeps us unmotivated? What keeps us procrastinating? Oftentimes, we don't make a decision because we think, I'm really not sure what I want to do. You know what I'm talking about? Indecision, just, you know, I don't know, maybe I'm just not. You ever feel that way? I'm not really sure. And here's what Donald Miller said. Don't kid yourself. Most of the times we say we're confused, we're not confused at all. We know exactly what we need to do. We just don't want to do it. We're afraid. We're afraid of failure. We're afraid of rejection. We fear the unknown. What's going to happen if I do it? Listen, if it's what God wants you to do, is it time for you to be living in paneled houses while my house lies in ruins? Just get started. A good plan today is better than a perfect plan tomorrow. Zig Ziglar, the great motivational writer, Christian author, said, people always say to me, Zig, you're always talking about motivation. And he says, motivation doesn't last. Can I get an amen? Motivation doesn't last. You know what Zig Ziglar said? He said, of course not. Of course it doesn't last. He says, it's just like bathing. That's why we recommend it daily. You need to get motivated every day. Motivated by the fact that God is in you. Motivated by the fact that God is with you, and he will give you the strength. And then finally, look down at the end of chapter 2, real quick, verses 10 to 23. I'm just going to skip through them. Write this down. God is for you. God is for you. In Zechariah 2, verse 10, it says, on such and such a day, of such and such a month, the word of the Lord came to the prophet Haggai. Verse 11. This is what the Lord Almighty says. And then what he describes in the next few verses is he says, you know, if you do, he's talking about the ceremonial law and how you're defiled and how foods become defiled, etc. And he gives them an example. But what he basically is saying is that when a person touches something that has been killed, something that's dead, they become ceremonially unclean. Right? The issue is death, life and death. And now go down to verse 15. He says, now give careful thought to this from this day on. Consider how things were before one stone was laid on another in the Lord's temple. And skip down to verse 18. From this day on, give careful thought to the day when the foundation of the Lord's temple was laid. Give careful thought. Verse 19. Excuse me. Is there yet any seed left in the barn Until now, the vine and the fig tree, the pomegranate and the olive tree, they haven't borne any fruit. What is he saying? He's saying, you guys sinned. You wouldn't repent. I sent everybody in the world to tell you, you better repent or the Assyrians are going to come and take you away and you're going to vanish from the face of the earth. That wasn't good enough. The 10 tribes in the north just kept doing what they were doing and now they're gone. Judah in the south, God says, did you see what happened to Israel? Did you see the Assyrian army that came in? If you don't repent, if you don't turn your life over to me, guess what? The Babylonians are going to come and they're going to take you to Babylon. And he says, you're going to be up there for 70 years. And you're going to suffer, you're going to hurt, you're going to lose everything. But if you'll trust me, if you'll be faithful, if you'll call on me, I'll bring you back. And so here they are, and Haggai's preaching to these people who have been there and done that, and they own all the t-shirts, and they've got all the bumper stickers to explain that God is in them, and God is with them, and now he wants them to remember something, because he knows it's going to be hard, and he knows it's going to be a struggle, and he says, I want you to know that God is for you. And look at what that verse says. Verse 19, is there yet any seed left in the barn? In other words, what have you got? How's your bank account look right now? How's your stock portfolio? You know, how's your 401k? It's empty. It's done. I'm broke. I don't have anything. I've lost everything. And then what does he say? From this day on, say it with me, I will bless you. From this day on, I will bless you. Look at verse 20. Then the word of the Lord came to Haggai a second time. Tell Zerubbabel, I'm going to shake the heavens and the earth. I'll overturn royal thrones and shatter the power of foreign kingdoms. I'll overthrow chariots and their drivers. Horses and their riders are going to fall, each by the sword of his brother. He's saying, I'm going to fight for you. I'm for you. Verse 23. On that day, declares the Lord Almighty, I will take you, my servant Zerubbabel, and I will make you like my signet ring, for I have what? I have chosen you. He says, from this day on, I'm going to bless you. He says, you know those signet rings that kings wear? And they take that hot wax and they seal a document. It's like an old primitive notary seal. And they take that wax and they take the king's ring that has the name or symbol of his dynasty. And they put that on. The signet ring was used to seal important covenants and agreements. To make guarantees that this is the king and he has the authority to do this. And he says, guess what? I'm going to make you like my signet ring. Isn't that beautiful? I'm going to seal this word in your heart. Hey, David, let's skip Deuteronomy and just go to Ephesians 1, 13 and 14. Listen to what Paul says. You also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with what? A seal. It's like when Jesus died on the cross, you remember one of his last words were, paid in full. It's like there was this bill due. The wages of sin is death. But God demonstrated his love for us, and that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. And God took his signet ring, and with the blood of Jesus Christ, he sealed that note, paid in full. You've been marked with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. And what does that mean? It means you're sealed with the fact that God is in you. You're sealed and marked that God will be with you. He'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. And that God is ultimately for you. Look at verse 14. He's a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. Friends, God is for you. The psalmist said, the Lord is for me. What can man do to me? The psalmist said, This I know, God is for me. And finally, look at Romans 8, 31 and 32. I love this verse. Romans 8, 31 and 32. What then shall we say in response to these things? What else is there to say? If God is for us, who can be against us? Verse 32. He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all. I want you to remember that because I'm going to come back to this verse in just a second. He didn't spare his own son. How did God choose to demonstrate his love for you and ultimately his purpose? What was it that he did? He gave his son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for you. How will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? God is in us, God is with us, and God is for us. Now, I want to close with a little story. Do you remember we started out talking about post-it notes? And how Dr. Spencer Silver kind of accidentally stumbled on this notion of these little sticky notes that you could use? You know what's interesting and curious about that is the idea for post-it notes didn't stick. He couldn't get any adherence. He couldn't get anybody to buy it. They couldn't find a way to market it. They tested it. They asked people. They did all these things. And for 5 long years, until 1973, they never found a market and they never found a way to mass produce it that was profitable. Now, you want to hear what happened? There was a man named Arthur Fry who worked at 3M, and he did not work in the office where Dr. Silver worked. But he heard about all the problems that they were having finding a solution. And so what Arthur Fry did was he looked at that and he thought, you know, that would help me. Because he said, I have this problem. Arthur Fry sang in the choir at his church. And he always had problems back in the old days. You know, choirs would have these books with all the different music and the words and the notes, and he had trouble keeping his pages separated. So Arthur Fry said, I'm going to take some of those little sticky notes, and I'm going to use those as bookmarks in my choir book at church. And when he started doing that, it worked like a charm. So they had the next big event they were doing. There was some expo. They got all these people together, and they just gave them all sticky notes, post-it notes. And they said, here, see if you can find some use for this. And here's what they found. Of everybody they gave these post-it notes to, 94% of the people said, I would buy this product. By the way, if you know anything about research and development, 94% of people never want to do anything. If you can get 10% of the population to buy your product, you're going to sell 30 million widgets, right? 94% of the population said, I can use this. And here's what they discovered. The post-it note was a solution without a problem for 5 years. And Arthur Fry made it profitable when he found the problem that it solved. Now listen to me this morning. If you're online and you're listening to me right now, I want you to hear this. I am convinced that for many, many people, Jesus is a solution without a problem. They believe in Jesus. They believe the Bible. They love to sing Christmas carols. Whenever there's a tragedy, they immediately want to help their fellow man. But on a daily basis, they just keep putting off their faith and their spiritual life. And what Haggai has done today is he's given us three post-it notes that are like biblical reminders of how to recover from the disease of spiritual procrastination. And I want you to see today, the fact that God is for us means he didn't spare his own son. And I want to ask you, what problem is Jesus the solution to in your life? What problem is Jesus the solution to? And I want to tell you this morning, the fundamental problem is that we as human beings are lost and dead in our sins without Christ. Most people think, well, I'm a pretty good person. You know, I've never killed anybody, you know. If you're here listening to me today and you would say, I don't know that I really need Jesus because I'm a pretty good person, what I would say to you today is what that professor said to W.H. Locke. This is your life. You may be a pretty good person compared to me. I'm not that great of a person. You may be a pretty good person compared to Osama bin Laden or Charles Manson. But that's not really the point, is it? W.H. Locke was paying a lot of money, or his parents or his government were paying a lot of money for that education he was getting, and he was wasting it. What price was paid for you to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? If you were a good enough person to connect with God on your own, then why would God have not spared his own son, but gave him up for us as a sacrifice? Friend, Jesus died on the cross because God is for you. Christ died for our sins. And Jesus rose from the dead so that God could be in you. You could pray a prayer and ask Christ to come into your life, be the center of your life, and commit your life to him. And that he would be with you, and he would never leave you and never forsake you. And here's the only question that really matters. What is God calling you to do now? Let's bow our heads and pray. With our heads bowed and eyes closed all over this room, if you're listening online or you're here today and God is speaking to you, you'll know it. It'll be like he's knocking on the door of your heart. Today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart and come. Come to Jesus. Give him your heart. Give him your life. He'll forgive you. He'll cleanse you. He'll change you. He'll make you a brand new person. You might be listening to me and you say, Pastor Stephen, to be honest, I don't know what I need, but I know I need something. And maybe God brought you here today to hear these words. It's not something you need. It's someone. I wonder if that was the loudest alarm that you've ever heard in your life. Friends, don't hit the snooze button. Say yes to Christ right now. Open your heart and let Jesus come in. He'll change you and forgive you. If you're a believer, whatever you know to do, say yes to Christ. Make that your prayer today. If you want to receive Christ, pray something like this. Just say, Dear Lord Jesus, come into my life. Come into my heart. Forgive my sin. The best I know how, I put my life in your hands. And if you prayed that prayer and you mean it, just say, Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Seal these words in our hearts, Lord, we pray. In Christ's name, amen.
Walking on.
change to come. Knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet.
If you know it, sing it with us and say it. Your promise.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet.
Your faithfulness.
my confidence. You never fail me yet. And I never will forget.
Come on, say you never.
You never fail me yet.
Amen. Hey, let's give him a big hand and say thank you today. Can I have that microphone and make sure it's on? God bless you, and be seated for just a quick minute. Thank you guys, worship team, so much for leading us. And you know, it's exciting to have Linda and Paul Mutchler back from a great vacation. And we have missed you guys, but we can see what a joy it was to be with your kids and grandkids and connect with friends. So we love the Mutchlers. Be sure and say hi to them with social distance today. But just let them know how much you love them. And we're going to close in a word of prayer. But this past week has been a special week. And I'm going to ask Bonnie to come up for just a minute. She's going to just say a quick word and then close us in a word of prayer. Do you guys love Bonnie? Yeah. Amen.
We're so excited for all of Broward County that we are all back in school on campuses around. So usually we pray for all the teachers, but it's kind of like, so that's not, we know how to do school, right? And so it's not near as stressful for us as it is for the kids. So we're going to ask all the kids that are back on campuses or at home, if you would stand up so we can see your faces, pray you through this school year as well as the teachers. So or why don't the teachers stand up? That might make it easy for them as well. Teachers and students around so we can pray for everybody. We're excited for all of you. I know some are nervous. I know for two of ours, they're seniors, so if you could pray for the Geigers, that would be helpful as well. But let's go to the Lord and pray for all these kids and teachers. Heavenly Father, thank you for another school year, for what that means for all of us as teachers and students. It's exciting. It can be we can have some anxiety and frustration. God, you know, as we heard this morning, that we need to keep our eyes on you, that these kids especially, Lord, as they find themselves here this morning, know that as they go to school every day of the week, they need to find themselves here on Sundays and Wednesday nights and whenever possible to be surrounded by other people of like mind and strong faith. And God, we lift this year up to you. God, we pray a hedge of protection about every single school, not just here in Broward County, but across this globe, for a hedge of protection. That as these kids walk into a school building, they feel completely safe from firearms, from viruses, from tests and things that bring them anxiety. God, we pray that you would watch over their minds as well as their physical bodies. Thank you for them. Thank you for the opportunity that you have placed Grace Point in, and that we sit here, Father, in this key spot between three schools so close to us. God, that we would be a lighthouse in this community. In Jesus' name, amen.
Seated. Thank you so much, Bonnie. We're certainly praying for all our kids next door that are in kids worship with Pastor Josh. Game day, our big kids outreach is coming up the first Wednesday in September. I think that's 2 weeks from now, but mark that on your calendar. Christian, Rocket Town for middle school and high school is this Wednesday night, and you're starting at 6:30? 7 p.m., so ignore that sign on the wall. But it'll be not, we changed the time from 6:30 to 7. So this Wednesday night, 7 o'clock, middle and high school, it's going to be awesome. Food, fun, music, God's word. It's going to be a great time. Hope you'll come out. And then the following Wednesday is game day for kids. We hope you'll be there and be a part of it. Wednesday night, we'll be online at 7 o'clock, finishing up our survey of the New Testament. We're going to go through the book of Revelation, and we're going to look at 7 blessings God has for you in the book of Revelation, Wednesday night at 7 o'clock online. And then, have you enjoyed going through the Minor Prophets this summer, Postcards from the Edge? Here's what we're going to do. I spent 3 months preaching through Zechariah earlier this year. So I'm not going to take a whole Sunday to do Zechariah because we really already did that. But next Sunday morning, we're going to tie a bow on this series by talking about Malachi, and we're going to finish with God's word, the last word, the last prophet in the Old Testament. Hope you'll be here. Bring somebody you know who needs to know Christ. Whoever you are, whatever you need, He is faithful and He is enough. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week. We'll see you this Wednesday and Sunday.